All right, y'all. So I'm gonna tell y'all a little story. You feel me? A lot of people who know me, you know what I'm saying? They already know I used to sell books and magazines door to door. Yes, that's. That's how I started my career. I started selling books and magazines door to door. So, you know what I'm saying? As y'all know, I got some crazy stories, you know what I mean? Some crazy stories, you know what I'm saying? So, I just was thinking like, dang, I should just start telling y'all some of the stories that, you know what I'm saying, that I've been through going door to door, because I know that it's a lot of door to door people out there. It's a lot of door to door people that done sold all types of things door to door, and you already know we come across some of the craziest stories. You feel me? We come across some of the craziest stories, man. Because of YouTube censory, you know what I'm saying, probably some of the stories I can't tell like I want to tell, you feel me? But I guess I'm gonna tell y'all one of the first stories, you feel me? Because I started going door to door when I was 16. Yeah, 16. So my mother was working. She was originally one working for, she was working for a magazine company, and they happened to be in Connecticut. I believe the magazine company was called Go Doers, you feel me? At the time, it was ran by a guy named Otis, you know what I'm saying? And I was coming straight out of high school, you feel me? And in high school, I was just like playing basketball, you know what I'm saying? I wasn't doing nothing extra hood and nothing like that. I was just a hooper, you feel me? I was hooping, I was playing basketball, and I was playing football. But at the time, my mother was out of town, and she always used to send us stuff. She used to send us shoes, she used to send us clothes, all type of stuff. And we used to, me and my brothers, we used to be wondering like, dang, what Mom's Duke's out there doing? Like, what does she do? You feel me? And the whole time, she was part of something called a magazine crew. You feel me? So anybody who done sold books and magazines door to door, y'all know about the crews. Y'all know about riding in vans, magazines, all of that. So at the time, I knew nothing about it. You know what I'm saying? I was just going up there. My mom was like, y'all want to come up here for the summer? So it was just like something to do during the summer. So, you know what I mean? We took a bus up there, Greyhound. Me and my brothers, we took a Greyhound bus up there, and we took a Greyhound bus to a ranch. They had a ranch. I don't remember where the ranch was. I know it was in like North Carolina or Virginia or something like that, but they had a, hold on, let me wait till this helicopter go by. So yeah, they had a ranch. So you know what I'm saying? We went out to the ranch. You know what I'm saying? Everybody was getting, it was like a banquet. Everybody was getting awards. Everybody was, you know what I'm saying, doing their thing. I just still didn't know what they were selling. I just know it was like a little, like a award show. Like, y'all remember how the MTV Rap Award Show? That's how this magazine company award show was. I mean, people was riding in. They was riding in some crazy whips, you know what I'm saying? And I was like, dang, man, these people are successful. I mean, the guy Otis had like 18-wheeler trucks and all type of stuff. And I'm like, dang, y'all doing all this from selling books and magazines door to door? That's what was tripping me out, because I asked everybody what they was doing, and they was talking about they was going door to door, selling books and magazines. But everybody had money, no cap. Everybody that I ran across had money. So I was like, dang, let me try this. You feel me? I mean, that's a little summer job. You know what I'm saying? It ended up being more than a summer job, because I never went back to school. You feel me? Not originally. I never went back to school. So I ended up going to Connecticut. They sent us to Connecticut. I remember the drive to Connecticut. My boy Jono was driving in Connecticut. And the reason I remember the drive to Connecticut is because when we was about to get to Connecticut, Jono was so tired from driving like 20 hours straight that he ended up going in the wrong direction of the highway. So he pulled out, we pulled out of somewhere, and this man turned in the complete wrong direction, complete. So we driving the wrong way, you know what I'm saying? And at the time, it was crazy because I didn't even have no license. I didn't know how to drive, but they had me like helping out with driving and stuff. So I felt like I was like part of the company. I'm like, dang, I'm helping out with driving. I'm lying about my age. This shorty's there, you know, all type of stuff. So I'm trying to get it in. You know what I'm saying? So at the end of the day, it's just like, we made it to Connecticut. So we made it to Connecticut. And
so yeah, y'all, they sent me and Jono in the 15 passenger van. I mean, the van was packed. I ain't had to sit in the back seat the first day. And I'll tell y'all more stories about sitting in the back seat, because that's one place you don't want to sit, and that's the back seat. But anyways, man, they sent me out there with Jono. You know what I'm saying? First day, we going door to door. He training me. So he was training me. I had like some big shirt on, some baggy jeans. I was dressed like Lil Wayne in 2008. You feel me? That's how we was dressed back then. I had the baggy white shirt, the baggy jeans, maybe some Forces on. And Jono had like the shirt and tie. Everybody was, you know, dressed nice. And I was kind of like bummed, because I was like, man, I don't got no nice clothes to dress, but I'm going to go out here and try it. I want to make me some money for the summertime. So as y'all see, I always been a hustler. I always been about getting that moolah, baby. But yeah, they sent me out with Jono. So the door we knocked on was like a little like a Caribbean lady. I'll never forget it. He gave his conversation, and that was just it. The whole day, this man wasn't getting no sales, none. Like, everybody was telling him no from selling books and magazines. And from my knowledge, he had just came from another crew. So the new crew he was on, they didn't even teach him the new sales pitch or the conversation or nothing. He came over there from the other crew saying some college type of conversation, like he was part of a school and all that. And Ms. Jones really wasn't buying that, you feel me? So I was just listening, you know what I'm saying? Trying to, you know, learn how to, you know, sell people. But by the end of the day, he made like a big sale. He sold one dude like 12 magazines off rip. I'll never forget it. The dude was ex-military, and this was new to me. He let us in his house off knowing us for like 5 minutes. He let two black guys in his house, you know what I'm saying, from knowing us from 5 minutes. So he let us in the house, you feel me? He was like he was in military, but he had a lot of like computer technology stuff inside his house. I just
remember him having a lot of he had a lot of computers and technology and stuff inside his house, and he had a dope whip from what I can remember. Now remember, this is like 16 years ago, so I'm trying to piece the piece together. Long story short, Jono hit him with the pitch, the presentation, the NCAA pitch. Back at the then, the NCAA pitch, like he was part of a school or something. Dude, he was like, what you need me to do? He said, I need you to do 12 magazines, because we were selling books and magazines, 12 books and magazines. And the dude was like, okay, I'll do it. So at the time, like me and Jono, I mean, Jono was really new. He wasn't really had been doing this, nothing for like a couple months. And this was my first day out there, so I'm stoked. I'm like, this dude about to buy 10 magazines. He showed me the price on the pricing list, so I kind of figured how much the magazines cost, so I'm doing it in my head. But if Jono knew what he knew today, he probably would have sold that guy for like over $1,000 for 12 magazines. But I think at the time, the magazines was real low. They real expensive now, people who go door-to-door magazines. But he sold them like 12 magazines for like $400, dude. Dude wrote the check out for $400 off knowing him for like 5 to 10 minutes. At that point, I was sold with selling books and magazines door to door. I was 16. I was like, man, I don't even know if I need to, you know what I'm saying? The dude, one of the managers, he was like, man, you need to go back to school. You a bright kid. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, man, I'm trying to get this paper. I'm trying to get this money. This guy just made $400. So simple, so easy in one day. And from that day on, sales had me sold. I was sold on that day on. That day, Jono trained me, created the Young Money in me, because that was my nickname. My mother's nickname on the sales crew was Black Widow. My nickname was Young Money. When I got my sales ducat, which is my credentials, I went crazy, y'all. But that's a whole nother story. I just wanted to tell y'all my first experience on how the first door I ever knocked on, and that's what it was, man. I joined the magazine crew when I was 16. I was trained by a guy named Jono. I was part of a crew ran by Otis, and then I got drafted to another crew ran by Miss Mary Ransom. So at the end of the day, you know what I'm saying, these people treated me good, man. You know what I'm saying, I was a kid coming straight out of school. I just wanted to make some money. You know what I'm saying, I wanted to help my moms out. You know what I'm saying, I wanted to help my brothers out, you feel me? And even though a lot of, you know, times I wish I would have went back to that school, it was kind of good that I picked up those skill sets at such a young age, because it was able for me to kind of like grow into a man at an early age and learn things from being around people that's, you know, around finance, that's doing finance and sales and stuff like that. So it kind of like, it taught me young
And it brought that hustle out of me at a young age. See, a lot of people at a young age, they don't got a work ethic because a lot of things was always given to them. I was thrown to the wolves at 16 to go out there and create an opportunity for myself. So that's what I would tell everybody out there, man. You know what I'm saying? Just put yourself out there. Create an opportunity for yourself. I was 16 making more sales than a lot of grown men that was there. That's how I got the respect that I got in the sales industry from selling books and magazines. Because at the gate, the manager used to be like, y'all letting this little 16-year-old come back with more sales than y'all. And you know, at the time, I still got the baby face. Like, I had the baby face, so it's just like, the people was opening up the doors for me. It was a little bit more easier for them to sell, for me to sell, you feel me? And I was killing them out the gate. That's why they call me the GOAT, you feel me? But yeah, it was crazy, man. At 16, I was going door to door selling books and magazines. I would have never thought that. In Connecticut, we was in, where is that? Bridgeport, Connecticut. And they had me in Greenwich, Connecticut. One of the most richest areas in Connecticut. I was working Greenwich, Connecticut, 16, selling books and magazines door to door. I'm a hustler, baby. But that's my story of how I got started. Going door to door. You feel me? My mom's working for a magazine company. We went out there for the summer, and then it was over from there. I went out there from the summer, and then I never came back to South Carolina. I ended up going to Cali and all of that. You feel me? So that's how my sales career pretty much started, guys. To all the entrepreneurs out there, or rising entrepreneurs, or even YouTubers, man, the best investment I would tell you is to invest into yourself. You know what I'm saying? Have positive mental attitude, power, manifestation, and believe in yourself. You feel me? Whatever you believe in, don't let nobody tell you wrong. You're going to have people that's going to try to steer you away. You're going to have people that's trying to hate off you. You're going to have people that's going to be a chameleon there and try to be around you to steal your energy. But stay true to yourself and always believe in yourself. You feel me? Stay true to yourself. Always believe in yourself. And if you believe into something, man, put 110% in it and don't let nobody steer you away from that, man. This is Soap Guys TV. Let me know what type of door-to-door stories y'all want to hear, man. I got a whole bunch of door-to-door stories, man. Let me know in the comments what type of door-to-door stories you want to hear, man. Make sure you like, subscribe, hit the notification bell because it helps the channel stay in the algorithms, man. As a new channel, I'm trying to get into the algorithm, so I'm going to need the community and the family to put, you know, Soap Guys TV in that type of position, man. But I'm out. Pigeon told, hide it from my folks, giving different strokes. Niggas bounce back like school dodgeball. You ain't really worth it if it's my call. I'm a hidden gem and you a slime ball. Check my bank balance, how could I fall? I'm a top shotter, you a low ball. When you in a bind, you get no call. If I'm in a pinch, bitches go harder. Got all the grind from my own father. Y'all need to move at a better pace. It's time to elevate. Breaking our barriers like I'm about to renovate. Remove the cancer, y'all niggas got dead away. Corrupt the brim.